Okay, please check the, is the screen visible here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine, fine. Yes, good. Okay, so in previous class, I discussed two things. Okay, so first thing is this one, the direction of the current flow. Okay, in case of generator and in case of motor, how to decide? Clear? And the voltage equation for them, for volt, for motor case and for the generator case. Clear? And now next, this torque equation was discussed. Okay, and from the torque equation we developed the EMF equation, right? This is your EMF equation, is back EMF. Okay, the back EMF equation is this one. This one is very important, right? And what are these terms? P is mean, P means the number of pole. Okay, whether it is 6 pole machine or 8 pole machine or 2 pole machine, based on that this P will be numbered, right? Next, this phi, what is phi? Phi means the maximum amount of flux in Weber. Okay, the peak value of flux, that's basically phi m. Next, z. Z means the number of conductor. Okay, next, number of rotation, that is the n in rpm. Clear? So these are the terms, and this A means the type of winding, whether it is wave winding or lap winding. Fine. So if it is lap winding, if it is lap winding, then it will be A equals to P. That means the number of pole, if it is 6, then the A value will be 6. Okay. And next one is the wave winding. Wave winding means the number of parallel path is only 2. That means your A value will be 2. Clear? So, okay, who is? So, this A means 2 in case of wave winding. So, that's how EB will be calculated. Next, today we will create the equation of EMF and the relation with the speed and flux. Okay, how it is developed? How with the change of the back EMF, rotation will be changed, right? So this equation already we developed for a motor, right? This equation we already developed, that is EB equals to V minus IARA for a DC motor. I am drawing the circuit configuration. Okay, this is your circuit configuration. In case of motor, it only consumes the electricity. Okay, this is your IA. Fine. This is your IA. This one. In case of motor. And this is your voltage. And if we exclude, if we subtract the voltage drop IA into RA, then we will get the value of EB. So EB will be less than V. So check here. EB is less than V, V minus IARA, where RA is the armature resistance. Clear? Okay. So now put the value of EB here. So if we know the value of EB, right here, this is P phi ZN, P phi z n by 68. Okay, and you all know the notations. Okay, what is described by these notations. So from here, at one side we will keep the voltage terms, and in another side I will keep the total RPM. Okay, we will check that if we change the voltage, how will the rotation change, or if we change the rotation, will there be any change in the current, or will there be any change in the voltage simultaneously? That we need to check, right? So from here we keep all the constant part, that 60A by ZP together, and then V minus IARA by pi. Now this position, these terms 60A by ZP, these are all constant because we cannot change the number of conductors in the armature, right? Because the construction is already fixed. We cannot change the type of winding because it is already done. We cannot change the number of poles in the system. So these are all constant. What we can change? We can change the number of, the amount of current. We can change the voltage here. Okay. So we will keep those variables in outside the bracket. Clear? Now look, this 60A by ZP, this part I am writing it as K. Okay, some constant. So from here you are getting what? N equals to EB by pi. Okay, because V minus IAR is nothing but EB. So N equals to EB by phi, or you can write also N equals to V minus IA RA by phi. Okay, you can write like that. Okay, now check how we can get for another portion if we change some value. Okay, suppose I am fixing this phi as constant part. Okay, I am keeping this phi as constant, right? And I am changing the value of this voltage V. Okay, so if I change the value of voltage V, then it will be a different rotation in 1 RPM of the rotor, okay, equals to V1, right? The IA value will be different. I don't know that. Okay, so I am writing it as IA1. RA value will remain constant for that particular motor, divided by phi. Okay, so now with the help of tachometer, there is one device which can measure the rotation of the rotor, rotation of the armature, rotation of the shaft. Okay, that can be measured by tachometer. Okay, you can search in internet TACHO. Okay, like your ammeter, voltmeter, multimeter, there is another meter, that is tachometer. Okay, so now I am doing what? Look, N by N1 equals to V minus IA RA divided by V1 minus IA1 into RA. Okay, which one is not known to me? IA1. So N value is known. You can check using the tachometer. N1 value you can check with using tachometer. Okay, voltage you can change and you can see using the voltmeter. Okay, so now IA1 from this calculation you can get. Okay, and if you check, if you apply some ammeter here, you will see that the value will remain almost 95% same. not much difference. Okay, so this is the speed dot characteristic. If we change the speed, the voltage will change, the torque will change. Okay, so that's the main moto hour. Next, so it is showing that the speed is directly proportional to the back EMF and inversely to the flux. That means N is directly proportional to EB, okay, and N is inversely proportional to the flux, that is phi. Okay, if you combine these two, you will get N equals to K into EB by phi, and then you can develop this equation. Okay, next we will learn how these graphs are coming here. Okay, what is omega? I already told you omega is the angular speed here. Okay, now if N value you can calculate, then from N you can calculate the omega value. Okay, because what is omega? Omega is nothing but 2 pi N by 60. Okay, so if you know the value of RPM, the value of omega you can calculate. Okay, now this is the T, that means this is your torque. Okay, your total power is constant, right? And you will see that if you are decreasing, if you are, your value of this R value, if it is increasing, then that waveform will be drooping in nature. It is linearly drooping in nature. Okay, there is one simulation also that if I get time, I will show you how this waveform you will get. Okay, so that value that is written in language, the speed is varied by wasting power in external resistor. Okay, that means here one rheostat is connected in series with the armature. Now this method is used in alternate load application, okay, where the duration of low speed operation forms only a small portion of the total running time and the nature will be always drooping in nature. That means it is linearly decreasing. If you increase the rheostat value, if you increase the rheostat, that means your resistance value, you will see that the torque, if you increase the torque, the omega value will decrease. Okay, that means mainly the RPM will decrease. Okay, next, the speed torque calculation. Okay, see here, it is also decreasing but little bit non-linear. Okay, next, speed. Okay, this is your speed, and if you increase the armature resistance, then your voltage drop will be more, right? Because that this is already known to you, right? N is directly proportional to V minus IAR. That means your EB. Okay, now this resistance will increase using the rheostat, right? Because if you use the rheostat, then what will happen? If you use the rheostat, this value, this IA rheostat, that means this will be RA plus R E, that means external. Okay, so ultimately your resistance is getting increased, so your ultimate value of EB will getting decreased, right? If your EB value is decreasing, then your speed will automatically decrease. Okay, so that's how you can say that if you increase the external resistance value, your speed will definitely decrease. Okay, Now, here also, this is the effect of variation of field current on the speed dot characteristic. That means this is, this x-axis is your field current, IF. Okay. This is your IF. What is your field current? Let's see. This is your motor. Okay. The shunt field coil is in parallel always. Okay. So, if you increase the current in the field coil, what will happen? The net current flow in the armature will get decreased, right? So, if the current of the armature is getting decreased, then what will happen? Okay. So, from here, you will see that you will get this kind of value. Okay. So, these are the characteristics of the DC motor. Okay. Now, the speed control techniques of separately excited DC motor. See, this question can be given in maximum cases as 5 marks in short note. Okay. In previous 1 year, as I can remember, I saw this question, they gave this question, that is speed control techniques of separately excited DC motor of 5 marks. Okay, so there are 3 methods, field control methods, field rheostat method and armature control method. That means, what is the meaning of field control? If you weaken the field or if you strengthen the field, your rotation will change because look, N is directly proportional to EB by phi. Okay, so if you kept EB constant, then what will happen? If you change, if you weaken the flux, then your speed will definitely getting high. Okay, if your flux is decreased, then your speed will getting higher. If your flux is getting higher, then the speed automatically will decrease. So, that is the field control method. Okay. So, see here it is already written, while the strengthening of field causes the decrease of speed. Okay. So, that's how you can adjust the speed. Next one is the field rheostat method. What is field rheostat? Already I told you that if you apply the external resistance, if you apply the external resistance with the armature, then total voltage drop IARA will increase. Okay, this part will increase and automatically the back EMF will be decreased because voltage drop is increasing and your back EMF is decreasing. So, if back EMF is decreasing, the rotation, the RPM value will also decrease. Okay. Okay, just a minute, I am having one call. Okay, sorry for the interruption. Okay, next one is the armature control method. So, likewise, this resistance, this rheostat method, other than the rheostat method, you can also control the from the armature. Okay, how you can control? By 2 method. One is armature resistance, that is RA. If you increase or decrease the RA value, then you can change the voltage drop your back EMF will be changed, so your rotation will be changed. As simple as that. Next, the armature terminal voltage. That means the voltage across the armature terminal. Look, this is your armature. Okay, where is your armature? Your armature is here. This is your armature. Okay. Here also your EB is developed here. Okay. And this is your voltage across the armature V. So if you change this value of V, if you increase the value of V, your EB value will increase. Okay. If you decrease the value of V, your EB value will decrease. So that's how you can change the speed. Okay. So these are, there are three main techniques: field control, field rheostat, and armature control method. Okay. So this is the characteristics. What I told you, what I described you, it is already written here. Okay. Now, so with this, your DC part, DC machine part is over. Now we will go to the three-phase induction motor. Okay. And before starting of the three-phase induction motor, how this rotating magnetic field is created? Till now, you already learned the magnetic field that is linear from N to S pole. It is not rotating in nature. Okay. This is your pole. This is your N. This is your S. Okay. This is your magnetic field, the direction of the magnetic field. Okay. This is the direction of your magnetic field. But it is not rotating in nature, right? So how this rotating magnetic field is developed, that we need to know now. So if we want to create the rotating magnetic field, we need six pole machine, okay, or three pole machine. A multiple of three pole machine is required, okay? And all those poles and their field coils must be connected, must be kept at 120 degree space difference, like this. Okay. This is three phase system, and we are going to create the three phase rotating magnetic field. Okay. So this is your red phase. Already you know from the AC circuit I told you that if we talk about the three phase system, then total three colored phase system I need to know, right? What are those? R phase, Y phase, and B phase. That means red, yellow, blue. Okay. Based on that, their color also change. That means the plastic coating above the wire also changes. Okay. So that's how we can identify which one is red phase, which one is blue phase, which one is yellow phase. Okay. So see here, this is your red phase. Okay. The reference, that is, this is your first pole. Okay. Next, another is this Y. Next phase. Right. Another one is your blue phase. Okay. Look, they all are 120 degree space separated. Correct. So how they are creating the three phase system? Just a minute. Let me show you the animation of this. You will understand this very clearly. Okay, let me check where it is. Just a minute. Where is it? Okay. Okay, yes, I got it. Just a minute. Let me share the screen here. Okay, please check whether the screen is visible or not.
Visible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Visible, no? Okay, good. Okay, look. This is the three-phase induction motor. Okay. This is the total coil, okay, which is in stator. Right? So, this is the first creation of the magnetic field, rotating magnetic field. Okay, see, this is the connection of considering only one coil, right? See, only one red coil. I hope you can see the movement of the pointer. Okay, this is the red coil, blue and yellow. Okay, now when you pass the current through anywhere, one magnetic field will be created, like using the Biot-Savart law. Okay, now here, if at 120 degree space difference, if these coils are put, then what will happen during the current flow? Look, during the current change, the magnetic field's concentration is also changed. Okay, at different space. Look, this is the first condition, okay, where around the red phase the magnetic field is created, right? You can see the dot, you can see the cross, that means the direction of the current flow. Okay, see, when this rotation is done, the angle is just changed. Okay, next, the angle is also changed. Why? Because due to the three phase current flow. Okay, you can also see the waveform here. Look. See, the direction of current, it is also changing. Okay, and as per the direction of change of the current, the strength of the magnetic field created around the conductor is also changed, and that's how it helps to rotate. Okay, it is only for the two pole winding. Next, this one is the three. Okay, you can see the current flow here, and if you know the frequency, you can calculate the omega, angular frequency. Look here, this is the four pole winding. Since here only four poles are present, that's why N1, N2, S1, yeah. S2. These four poles are created. Okay. When N1 and S1 is present here, okay, learn carefully. When N1 and S1 is present here, when the strength of the S1 and N1 is connected with each other, then it attracts the wire, the rotor wire, okay, and then N2 and S2, it also attracts the rotor wire. Okay, so that's how basically this magnetic field is rotating. Okay, this is omega is equals to 4 pi f. Now it is applied in this machine. See, it is your 10 pole machine. okay, and frequency is 60 hertz. So since the number of pole is more, the number of generation of this magnetic field are also more than the four pole machine. That's how the rotation of this case is much higher. Okay, I will also upload that in the Google Classroom. Okay, so that's how this, just a minute, so that's how the magnetic field, the rotating magnetic field you can create. Okay, so here now the three phase system is present. Okay, the flux we will consider, equations are phi r equals to phi m sin omega t, that means it starts from the 0 0 position. Next, phi y, which is 120 degree lagging condition with respect to r. Then phi b, that is also 240 degree lagging, or I can say 120 degree leading, because I can also write this equation as per trigonometric equation, that is phi m into sine omega t plus 120. Okay, omega t plus 120. So from observing this equation, I can also say that it is 120 degree leading condition with respect to the red phase. Okay, this is the waveform propagation for three phases. Okay, it is also written here phi r, phi y and phi b. Okay, now for any particular time, for any at particular angle, we will check that what is the maximum amount of flux that can be developed in three phase. Okay, so as per this graphical value, see, at 0 degree, what is the maximum value of the flux for phi r? That is 0, because at omega t, just put the value of 0, the angle. Okay, what is omega t? That is theta equals to omega t. Okay, what is theta? That is the angle. Now if theta is 0, then phi r value is 0. Okay, see, no phi r value is present here. Phi r value is not present. Clear? Next, phi y, if you put 0, the value becomes minus root 3 by 2 phi m. Clear? Next, in case of phi b, it is root 3 by 2 into phi m. So now we have to do the vector addition. Okay, so if you do the vector addition, you will see that net amount of flux for this three phase system is 3 by 2 phi m. 3 by 2 phi m. That means 1.5. So you are giving, you are developing a particular amount of flux phi m, but in net result, you are getting 3 by 2 phi m. That means 1.5 times of the flux. So that is basically beneficial to us. We are generating, we are giving a particular amount of current which develops the phi, which develops the particular flux phi. But in resultant, see, I am getting 1.5 times of the maximum flux. So in case of three phase system, that's why it is advantageous. Okay, so now let's check for another angle. Here I am considering only 0 degree. Okay, so if I put 30 degree, that means pi by 6 radian, then what will happen? So if pi by 6, that means 30 degree, so put here at in place of omega t equals to 30 degree. So this value will become only half. Okay, this value will become only half phi m. This phi y value becomes minus phi m, and phi b becomes half phi m. So ultimately, look here, this is the value of half phi m. Okay, what is the value of phi b? Phi b is also half phi m. What is the value of phi y? That is minus phi m. So this is your phi y. This is your basically phi y, but it is minus. So now do the resultant calculation. Okay, you will see that total value is also 1.5 times of the total flux. So from here, what we can say? We can say whatever be the angle propagation, whatever be the angular displacement of the field coil, we can say that your maximum flux that you will get is 1.5 times of the phi m. Okay, next, the construction. So basically construction, the theoretical part is given here. It is not much asked, but I put here. Okay, see, this is the basic outing structure of the three phase induction motor. This is the motor terminal. Here three phase winding is present. Okay, just like your DC machine, here only the type of windings are different, the connection of windings are different. They are connected in 120 degree space difference. Okay, just like the DC, here laminated core is used to reduce the eddy current loss. Okay, here also one shaft is there from where we will get the rotating power. Okay, where we will get the output power, right? So all the terms are here, all the connections, all the parts are already shown in this configuration. Okay, see, this is your stator winding because it is already stationary. Now there are two types of rotor in case of induction motor. Okay, three phase induction motor. One is squirrel cage, squirrel. One is squirrel cage. Okay, another one is the wound rotor. Okay, so just a minute. Okay, so squirrel cage motor, squirrel cage rotor, and wound rotor, WOUND, or it is also known as slip ring. Okay, it is also called the slip ring rotor. Two types of rotors are there. Okay, here the revolving rotors, its description is here. Okay, it is composed of laminations that just like the DC machine. Okay, a series of rotor slots are there where rotor coils are connected, right, providing the space of the rotor winding. Now conventional three phase windings made of insulated wire wound rotor similar to the winding on the stator. Okay, now in aluminium, in this squirrel cage rotor, the aluminium bus bars are connected and shorted like this. These are the aluminium bars. You can see these bars are aluminium bars. Okay, these bars are aluminium bars and they are not connected in straight line format. Okay, it is something skewed. That means if your rotor like this, these are connected, these bars are connected like this. Okay, just like it is tilted with respect to in a particular angle. Okay, it is not connected in straight line formation, it is connected in some tilted formation. Okay, so this is the squirrel cage. In either case, the rotor windings are contained in slots in a laminated iron core and which is mounted on the shaft. Okay, now the motor having the first type of rotor is known as squirrel cage induction motor, and this rotor is cheap, simple and rugged construction. That means it is basically so heavyweight. Okay, rugged construction. Now it's cylindrical in shape obviously, and it is made of sheet steel laminations. Already laminations, you are learning that the laminations are done to reduce the eddy current loss. Okay, so why these connections, this connection of the aluminium rotors are skewed? To reduce the magnetic harm, because you will hear that when a rotor is rotating, a particular buzzing sound is coming from the rotor. Okay, to reduce that buzzing sound, to reduce that humming sound, this skewing is done. Okay, and second option is to reduce the magnetic locking. What is the meaning of magnetic locking? Suppose a machine is rotating and suddenly it just stops. Okay, you are passing the current. Okay, the magnetic fields, the field coils all are energized, but the rotor is still not rotating. That meaning is magnetic locking. Okay, the attraction of North Pole and attraction of South Pole becomes equal. Okay, so they neither attracts nor they repulses. Okay, so that is called the magnetic locking. Okay, to reduce that locking, to reduce the magnetic hum, we are doing the skewing. Okay, this one is very important. It is given also in MCQ question. Okay, the what is the purpose of skewing? So two purposes, right? So that is the squirrel cage rotor. So skewing is happened in the squirrel cage rotor, not in wound rotor. Okay, now what is the difference then? All the differences are written here, like no rotor terminals in squirrel cage, no rotor terminals available, hence no external connections can be made in the rotor circuit. But in wound rotor, we can add external resistance to change the speed. Okay, next, in squirrel cage rotor, no slip rings and brushes are there, but in wound rotor motor, there are slip rings, okay, and brushes, carbon brush, that is present in DC machine. Okay, basically due to their constructional difference, these two types of motor are working, are functioning in different way. Okay, this squirrel cage rotor, this squirrel cage motor is cheapest, but it is costlier in case of wound rotor. Okay, so all the differences are written. This difference can be given as short note, okay, of 5 marks. Short note. Now this principal operation of the three-phase motor. Okay, now What is the principle of operation? A three-phase induction motor has the stator winding, and there we are giving the three-phase balanced power supply. Okay, this is your three-phase balanced power supply. R, Y, and this is your B. Okay, three-phase power supply is given. This rotor is not excited from any source. It has only magnetic coupling with the stator. Okay, under normal running condition, the rotor winding is always short-circuited to allow the induced currents to flow in the rotor winding. That means when you are passing the current in the field coils around the pole, that means stator connection, then it creates a magnetic field. That magnetic field is cut in the rotor, so one current is flowing in the rotor. Okay, and then due to attraction and repulsion process, as I shown you, it rotates. Okay, the flow of three-phase currents in the stator winding produces the rotating magnetic field of constant amplitude and rotates at a synchronous speed. Okay, now suppose the rotor is standstill. That means it is basically at zero point. It is already stopped. It is at initial condition. Okay, the rotating rotor field induces an EMF in the rotor conductor by the transformer action, like your induction process. Okay, now since the rotor circuit is closed set of conductor, the current flows in the rotor circuit. Okay, this rotor current then produces the rotor field. The interaction of the stator and rotor field produces the torque. Okay, the stator field produces the torque of this side, and the rotor field produces the torque in opposite side, but of lower value. Okay, the resultant speed is that speed with which the rotor rotates. Okay, it is also written here, like using the Lenz's law. As per Lenz's law, the rotor field will try to oppose the very cause of its production. So this is the cause, the stator field is the cause, and the rotor field is the effect. Okay, this rotor field is the effect. So now the relative speed between two, if it is zero, then the rotor will not rotate. Okay, and if it is not zero, then in either side, whatever is greater, it will rotate. Okay, and that is called the rotor speed. That is, speed is called the rotor speed. Okay, and what is this difference? This difference is called the slip. Okay, this difference of speed is called slip, right? So it is the way that three-phase induction motor catches up the speed in gradual time. Okay, now when the rotor is at standstill, the relative motion between the stator field and rotor is maximum. Okay, so the EMF in the rotor and the rotor current are reduced. However, the rotor cannot attain the speed of the stator field, which is equal to the synchronous speed. Now, here you are learning a particular term which is very important. That is synchronous speed. We denote this synchronous speed by M suffix S. Okay. This value is 120 F by T. Okay, if your number of pole if your number of pole of the machine is, if the number of pole in the machine is suppose 10, okay, the frequency is 50, then what is your NS, what is your synchronous speed? The synchronous speed is that speed beyond which the machine cannot rotate, the machine cannot run. It is the maximum amount of speed. Okay, that is 120 into 50 by 10. So one, this 00 will be cancelled out. So you will get the 600 RPM. Okay, that is the synchronous speed. Right. Now, this is eventually due to the reason that if the rotor is moving at synchronous speed, there will be no relative motion. So basically, in between the stator field and rotor field, there is no relative motion. So that will, then the motor will stop running. Okay, but the rotor induced EMF and current never become zero. Okay, the rotor never can attain the synchronous speed in case of induction motor. It runs somewhat less than the speed, that is called the rotor speed. Okay, so suppose the rotor speed is 550 RPM, it is less than the stator speed. Okay, 550 RPM. So what is the slip then? The slip you can calculate like this: NS minus NR divided by NS. Okay, so put the value 600 minus 550 divided by 600. So ultimately you will get what, 5 by 60, so 1 by 12. Okay, I don't know what value you will get of the slip. Okay, this is the value of slip, small s. Okay, it is almost I think 12896, so almost 8%. Okay, the slip is always denoted like this, 8% slip, or 4% slip, or 5% slip, like this. Okay, now if the rotor speed falls below the synchronous speed, the rotor EMF and current will continue to increase and the electromagnetic torque continues to increase and the rotor rotates. So that is the process how the three-phase induction motor rotates. Okay, so your today's class is up to this. Okay, so today you learned two new terms. One is synchronous speed, another one is slip. What is the synchronous speed? The maximum amount of rotation, the maximum amount of speed that can attain the by the machine. It is called the synchronous speed. Basically, it is the speed of the rotor field, a stator field. Okay, it is the speed of the stator magnetic field. That is the synchronous speed. Okay, what is the rotor speed? Rotor speed is denoted by N small r. Suppose the rotor speed is 550. In case of three-phase induction motor, the rotor speed is always less than the synchronous speed. And then subtracted amount is called the slip. The rate of change of RPM is called the slip. Okay, that means NS minus NR divided by NS. So this is your slip calculation. Okay, so your today's class is up to this. So thank you very much for attending the class. If you have any question, you can ask. All of you give your attendance in the chat box.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
थैंक यू सर.
थैंक यू.